Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you have caused this holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that we, who have known the mystery of that light on earth, may also enjoy him perfectly in heaven, where with you and the Holy Spirit he lives and reigns, one God in glory everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who have lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you are broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be buried as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son is given. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness. From this time onwards and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of Paul to Titus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Christ.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round on them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We expect Christmas each and every year. It is probably one of the most prepared for days of the entire calendar year. Each year, we mark and note the date, and we count down to the date itself. In church, we do that through the season of Advent. We prepare liturgically and in prayer. Outside of the church, there are all sorts of fun countdown calendars that exist. Some offer a small container of jam for each of the days leading up, not so much in Advent, but in December up till Christmas. Some others offer chocolates or a poem for each day leading up to the day. We even got one this year for our cat that has 25 cat treats that she gets over the course of the month. She's really, really loved December this year. In the United States, Christmas is so looked forward to and advertised that even somebody without any connection to the Christian faith whatsoever would have a hard time remaining unaware that something was coming today and tomorrow. This pervasive awareness stands in stark contrast to the first Christmas. The first Christmas came like a thief in the night. And it was not, at least by human standards, something that was well planned. I mean, there wasn't even a room set aside for the Holy Family. They had to stay with the animals. This difference points us to something essential about what we've gathered here this evening to celebrate. No matter how much we prepare, God's arrival looks more like the simplicity and surprise of that first Christmas, as described in St. Luke's Gospel, than it does our glorious celebration with candles and flowers and music. A small affair in a humble location that transforms everything. God comes when we least expect it. In times of darkness, in moments of despair and hopelessness, God in Christ comes to us. In the unremarkable day-to-day patterns of our lives, Christ comes to us. Christ comes unlooked for, breaks into the darkness. The splendor of this night and tomorrow's quieter feast, where many of us will gather together with family, exchange gifts, are reminders that Christ does, in fact, come. And they are worthy celebrations of his coming into our lives, not just at Christmas, but over and over again. Each year we come together to celebrate that Christ arrives when we need him. Christ comes to us as a guest. A guest that is simultaneously long expected and unexpected. God has not come to us in a powerful guise, but in great humility. He joins himself to the lowliest among us. The God of all creation chooses to become finite, limited, human. He does not come as a king, though that is what he is. He does not come as a great power, though he is power itself. Instead, God chooses to come to us as one for whom there is not even room to be found in which to be born, who is laid in a feeding trough because the inn was overbooked. God has lowered God's self to meet us where we are. In the letter to the church in Philippi, St. Paul summarizes the miracle of the incarnation in the form of a poem. He writes, "Jesus, who though he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, assuming human likeness. And being found in appearance as a human, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." When we celebrate the incarnation of God, when we celebrate Christmas, we celebrate the fact that God loves us so much that God chose to become powerless for us in order to be with us. At Christmas each year, we are assured and reminded that we are not alone. That in Christ, God took on our pain, took on our frailty, so that we would not ever be alone. To assure us that there is nothing that can ever separate us from the love of God. Now, this is all very good news all on its own, but that's not even the whole of the story. God did not come to join us in our humanity to make a simple social call. God comes to us. God joins us so that in Christ we can be restored to wholeness and raised to glory. God did not come down to our level to leave us there. God comes to stand with us so that we might be raised and stand with him. He has taken on our frailty so that we can join him in his divinity. Each year at Christmas, we celebrate the implications of God choosing to join us in our pain, join us in our sorrows. We celebrate the fact that God refuses to leave us where we are. We remind ourselves that we are not alone and have been given a gift of abundant life beyond our wildest imaginings. My friends, what we celebrate this day is absolutely worth marking on a calendar. It is worth the countdowns, the preparations that we undertake each year. It is worth circling in bright pen, setting digital reminders that'll wake us up in the middle of the night to remind us that Christmas is coming, to remind us that we are not alone in the darkness and fear that are so prevalent in the world around us, and that not only are we not alone, but we have a God who has sacrificed all to raise us up out of that fear, out of that despair, through the most unlikely of means. Emmanuel has come. God is with us indeed. God is with us to comfort us, to love us, and to invariably draw us into abundant life. Merry Christmas.
Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We look in an apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us offer our prayers to Christ our Savior, born this holy night, saying, "Hear our prayer." For people around the world celebrating this night, for hope to light our way, for hearts open to receive the newborn King, for grace to bear witness to the wonder of God's love. Fill us with good news of great joy for all people. Christ our Savior, born this holy night.
Hear our prayer.
For this community, this nation, and the world, for those who work through this night serving others, particularly police, firefighters, and EMTs, for all who bear the weight of authority, for the courage to resist hatred and oppression, for all who live in the midst of terror, war, and conflict, for refugees who, like Joseph, Mary, and their child, flee from danger, for the members of our armed forces. Be for us, O Lord, the Prince of Peace, Christ our Savior, born this holy night. For all whom it would be easy for us to forget, for fragile and vulnerable children, for the poor and the hungry, for people without a place to stay, for the sad, the lonely, and the isolated. May we show compassion for the sake of the humble child who came to us in a stable because there was no room in the inn. Christ our Savior, born this holy night. For those who wait for the light of healing, for those who have been commended to our prayers, for people suffering from COVID, for people throughout the world living with HIV and AIDS, for those struggling with addiction and those in recovery, for strength for all healthcare workers and caregivers, for those whom we now name. Comfort their hearts with the message of the angel. Do not be afraid. Christ our Savior, born this holy night. For those who have died, for William Winterbotham Woodside Jr., Logan Blair Christie, and Susan Claw. For those in whose memory flowers and music are given this Christmas, for victims of gun violence, for all who mourn, for those whom we now remember. With all the heavenly host, may they behold the radiance of your glory. Christ our Savior, born this holy night.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you with all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Good evening and Merry Christmas to everyone here at Calvary Episcopal Church. Glad you've joined us for this celebration of the Incarnation. If you are a guest tonight, we hope you'll take a few moments and fill out one of the cards in the back of the pews and put that in the offertory plate, and Cameron or I will be in contact with you this upcoming week. If you're looking for a church home, we'd be very happy to talk about Calvary as a possibility for you. Upcoming on Saturday, January 27th, is an annual event that is called Chili Fest. It's to have a gathering with warm food and friends in the midst of cold wintertime. It is particularly for those new to the life of Calvary in the last year. You will see more about that in upcoming bulletins. Thank you all to the musicians for both services. Some of us come just at 4 o'clock. Some of us come at 4 and 11. All the musicians do, the singers, other musicians, as well as altar guild, flower guild, acolytes, clergy, and so on. Thank you very much for participating. And thank you very much to Emma Schauf and her family for doing all the flowers in here. It's really a lovely job. Tomorrow at 9:30 a.m., we'll celebrate the Incarnation again with one service here in the church. And the next Sunday, we'll be back to 8, 9, and 11 regular Sunday worship. You'll see a note in the bulletin about the walk-in ministry at Trinity Cathedral. That's an opportunity for us to help our neighbors in need, particularly those downtown. If you have any cold weather gear, gloves, hats, scarves, mittens, and so on, please bring them to church and we will take them downtown. They'll be put to immediate use. You'll see also a note about the capital campaign there in the bulletin. We've had a very soft, quiet rollout of that. Beginning in the new year, we'll begin to talk about that quite a bit more. But I'm pleased to say, with just the committee, vestry, and a handful of others, we now have signed commitments for $1.8 million to support the mission and ministry of Calvary Church. Thank you all very much for your generosity. Merry Christmas. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit has made perfect man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you made known to us in creation, and the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to this command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Amen.
the gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God, who sent his Son to take our nature upon him, bless you in this holy season, scatter the darkness of sin, and brighten your heart with the light of his holiness. Amen. May God, who sent his angels to proclaim the glad news of our Savior's birth, fill you with joy and make you heralds of the gospel. Amen. May God, who with the Word made flesh, join heaven to earth and earth to heaven, give you his peace and favor.
Amen.
The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.